Okay, welcome everyone to this second session of the day. Maribel Fierro is going to take us to the Islamic West. Maribel Fierro is research professor at the Center of Human and Social Sciences at the Higher Council for Scientific Research, CSIC in Madrid. She has worked and published on the political, religious, and intellectual history of Al-Andalus and the Islamic West, on Islamic law and on violence and its representation in medieval Arabic sources. Among her recent publications, The Almohad Revolution, Politics and Religion in the Islamic West during the 12th and 13th centuries, which is a very old collection, 2012, and a forthcoming volume, Knowledge, Heresy and Politics in the Medieval Islamic West. She is the editor of Volume 2, The Western Islamic World, 11th to 18th Centuries, of the New Cambridge History of Islam, 2010. Orthodoxy and Heresy in Islam, Critical Concepts in Religious Studies, 4 volumes, 2013. And she co-edited several volumes, most recently, Legal Status of Dhimmis in the Islamic West, 2013. Ibn Hazm of Cordoba, Life and Works of a Controversial Thinker, 2012, and most recently, Accusations of Unbelief in Islam, a diachronic perspective on takfir, which appeared last year. And the topic of the present presentation, as you see, is Who is a Convert? Some Early Reports from the Islamic West.
Thank you, Camila. Everybody. Thank you, Camille, also for helping me with the small PowerPoint. I didn't bring my computer, so she helped me, so she's responsible for it. So, I have dealt, I'm going to deal with some text having to do in one way or another with.
One moment, please. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's not working. Yeah. Having to do with conversion. Not I think this. I have dealt before with issues of conversion in Islamization in Al-Andalus before, but just last year I was asked to contribute to a conference which was held in St. Andrews University on the process of Islamization in general within the framework of a ERC grant that has to do with Islamization of Anatolia. And there was a general conference dealing with Islamization in general in different in the different areas of the Islamic world. And I was asked to prepare an overview of the state of the art and recent debates and polemics regarding the case of Al-Andalus. And then I realized that such an overview did not exist, and that in fact there are many scattered articles dealing with this, and that such a topic deserved maybe a monograph. So I'm also thankful for this opportunity because I had to revisit some of the texts that I looked at them then. So I much welcome the invitation to take part in this workshop and, as I say, to present some of the texts that I have been collecting and studying. I've been talking about Al-Andalus, but the first text, you must have realized, that does not deal with Al-Andalus, but with the Islamization in North Africa, and specifically with that of a Berber tribe, the Lawata. I have included it here for the following reasons. First of all, let me connect with something that Michael Lecker said yesterday. He mentioned the sin, but not the sinner. I was the one who asked him once, I had forgotten, whether he studied the Jews of Medina because he was himself a Jew. And the question, of course, has very much to do with my own scholarship. Do I study Al-Andalus because I'm a Spaniard? And of course, the answer is yes. And this is the same for most of my Spanish colleagues. Things are changing, but most of Spanish scholarship on Islam has to do with the history of Al-Andalus. There are certain differences, and it could be qualified according to the position one takes regarding the integration or disintegration of Al-Andalus into the national history of Spain, and that will mark a border among us. But of course, I was trained to deal with Al-Andalus, and that is what I have done for most of my scholarly life. But over the years, I became more and more convinced that the history of Al-Andalus has to be written in conjunction with that of North Africa. Something that is very much against the tradition of my academic milieu, because usually in the history of the Spanish Arabists, what we tried to convince ourselves and others was that the history of Al-Andalus was very special, and it had more to do with Europe than with the Islamic, that with the Islamic world, and that against what the French had said, that Africa starts in the Pyrenees, Africa started in the Straits of Gibraltar. So, but I now believe that I cannot understand what's going on in Al-Andalus without studying the Maghreb, but of course, there are many differences. Still, it cannot be explained without it. So, in the text that I have, the first text is about the conversion of a tribe. And this is something that we never find for the case of Al-Andalus. We don't have stories about conversion of groups. We have stories about conversions of individuals, not of tribes for sure. I brought it because it deals with a bodily practice, which I found quite interesting, that according to this story, which comes from an Ibadi source, from a Hariji local source, local North African source, it marked their conversion to Islam. They shaved their faces and their heads. Now, this was a practice that was also followed by the Berbers of Al-Andalus, especially those who settled in the central regions of the Iberian Peninsula. Although it is explained in a different way, it doesn't mark recent converts. In Al-Andalus, it marks Berbers against Arabs. And it's specifically mentioned in the moment of the great Berber revolt against the Arabs in the 20s of the second century, when it is said that the Berbers who had settled in the Meseta, in the central area of the Iberian Peninsula, and who had rebelled against the Arabs, shaved their heads in order to know who were for them and who were against them. Probably meaning that there were Berbers also in the Arab army and they had to distinguish themselves. It seems, but it is something that I'm still working on, that Berbers, tribal allegiance was signaled by shaving part of the head. Some will shave the whole head and leave just some hair here, others here. This is something that was still witnessed in the 20th century in some areas of Morocco. So by shaving their heads, they would, the message was, we are looking for a common identity against the tribal ones. No. From the first century Hijra, we now move to the third century, so from the second, sorry, we now move, well, so from the first and the second in the case of the Berbers of Al-Andalus, we now move to the third century in the second text. This is a text that I like very much because, not because so much of the story, but because the protagonist there is one of the baddest of the baddies in the history of Al-Andalus, who is Hashim ben Abdelaziz. I mean, he's really evil. He's always portrayed as doing evil things, and this is one of the most evil things he does. As you see, at the end, God-fearing Muslims who disliked what he had done buy the especially the children captives, and they free them because they think they are Muslims, they are sons of Muslims, and that Hashim has done something which is wrong. These God-fearing Muslims don't seem to have done anything in order to stop the massacre of the men but they do something for the children. And yesterday with the story of the Banu Qurayda, I was thinking also a lot about this text. But I think the important character is Hashim bin Abdelaziz. He was the descendant of one of the Arab conquerors of Al-Andalus, who was also an Umayyad Mawla. And his family had many land properties in the south of Al-Andalus. And they obviously had a lot of money, they had a lot of wealth, they had also clients of their own, and they were highly influential at court. And Hashim was a kind of al-Mansur avant la lettre. He really held a lot of power in Cordoba. But what he represents in the history of Umayyad al-Andalus is the opposition of the old Muslims of convert origin against the new converts. He appears in a number of stories trying to stop recently convert people to get positions of power in the Umayyad administration. So he represents the old Umayyad Mawali family who want to have the field for themselves and are trying to close the field for newcomers. So he's held responsible for the many of the Muwallads, we'll talk about this term later on, who rebel in the second half of the 9th century, especially Ben Hafsun. So he appears in a number of stories with this, some of these rebels of Muwallad origin have been defeated, they are brought to Cordoba, and the emir is trying to get them into the army, but Hashim makes their life very difficult. So at the end, they realize that their life is going to be very difficult in Cordoba, and they leave the capital and rebel again. So Hashim is responsible for these kind of things. It's not the emir, but it's Hashim, the scapegoat of all this bad treatment of the recent converts. The period that is being described here is the second half of the 9th century, which is the a period known as the Fitna, because many Arab, Berber, and Muwallad lords rebelled against Cordoba. Some would say that they actually did not rebel. They had enjoyed a lot of autonomy, and it's the Cordoban state which is trying to get more and more impose their authority on this area. So they are reacting against the expansion of the Cordoban state. And one of the most important of these lords who rebelled at this time was Ben Hafsun, with whom the fourth text is dealing with. And as I said, these were Arabs, Berbers, and Muwalladun. Now the term Muwalladun, I learned that, everybody who deals with the history of Al-Andalus knows the term Muwalladun in plural, but apparently it's not so common in other sources. I learned that from the article on Mawali by Patricia Cron in the Encyclopedia of Islam, where she said this is a term that is with these characteristics only appears in the Andalusi sources, is usually understood as meaning local converts, but the term, and I owe that to Gauthier Jainborg, means one who is not an Arab and is raised among Arabs and behaves like an Arab. So it seems to say more about Arabization and not so much about Islamization. We usually assume that the Muwalladun are converts, but in fact there are a few texts in which a difference is made between al Muwalladun or al Musalima. So there seems, for them, Muwalladun was not exactly a Muslim, it was someone who looked like an Arab. So what we have here is a group of local people who have become highly Arabized, and they became highly Arabized because the Arabs in the Iberian Peninsula did not settle in camps in Misr, in Amsar. There were no Amsar. They settled on the land and they mixed with the population. So it seems that a higher portion of the population was able to get Arabized quicker than in other areas, much more than in most of North Africa, especially the extreme Maghreb, where there were no Arabs until quite late. Many of these Mughalad lords, we know this for the sources, their armies, some of their armies were recruited among the Christian population. And in the case of Ben Hafsun, when Abderrahman III finally manages to get rid of him and of his sons, there are many scenes describing how he arrived in a village that had supported Ben Hafsun and it was all inhabited by Christians, and how they were massacred and so on. As I said, the scene described in this text is one of the most powerful representations of the evil behavior of Hashim. And sorry, because Camila did the, and I didn't put, this is the Lawata country. This is the areas of the revolts of the Arab Berbers and Mughalad lords during the 9th century. And in this scene, in spite of having given the amount to the inhabitants of the fortress, Hashim kills those who say that they are Ajam. Again, the emphasis is put in that they are non-Arabs, although the term is used also to mean non-Muslim. In the case of those who claim that they are Muslims, he makes them recite Quranic verses and hadith, but this was not good enough to save them because Hashim would accuse them of having learned those verses and hadiths the night before. And if they stammered with their pronunciation, this would prove that they were not Arabs again and had them beheaded, taking captives their women and children. And as I said, the end of the story has these good Muslims, these God-fearing Muslims, intervening in order to try to solve part of the bad things that Hashim has done. The third text also comes from the second half of the 9th century, and it deals with another story of how old converts, members of the powerful families of Umayyad Mawali in Cordoba, resented the ascent of new converts. Yesterday I said that the biographical dictionaries written in Al-Andalus do not have stories, and the second text, the text 3 has two parts. The B part seems to prove me wrong, but in fact the author is a North African, Muhammad Belharith al-Hushani, who emigrated from North Africa under the Fatimids to Al-Andalus, and he wrote the first history of the Judges of Cordoba, which has a lot of stories, and many of them are very, very good stories, like this one. It's a very good story with lots of characters. We have the Umayyad Mawali again, who are trying to get all the positions at court and stopping the new converts to transform their conversion into privileges. We have Kumis, the secretary who by chance, this Christian who is in the entourage of the court and by the sickness of the secretary manages to get the position. There is his friend Ben Matruh, which is one of the parts I like best, when Kumis is afraid that Hashim is going to take any occasion to get rid of him. And his friend comes in the night and tries to get in the house and he doesn't let him in, saying, if I let you in, I would have to let others, and if I don't let you in, then it shows that this is something, a peculiarity of mine that I don't have to explain. Later in the other story, there is the Muhtasib, when he dies, that goes to the Qadi and says, well, he might have died as a Christian and not as a Muslim, and therefore he's the emir, Hashim says the emir should inherit from him, or the public treasury. There is the judge who behaves quite correctly, and there is the people. I mean, at a certain moment it is said, well, the common people started to talk about this case, and it would seem that this comes after, I think, Ben Matruh has said, how will we doubt that he converted to Islam if he just was praying all the time in the mosque? the mosque. He would be praying there in the mosque of Cordoba, so that if he was praying in the mosque and everybody was able to see that, when he started to be the fact that he was a Muslim started to be doubted, the common people started to talk about it. And then, so the judge had pressure on several fronts. There were the Mawali family, who will be giving testimony against Kumis, but Ben Matruh would be saying, other his friends, the friends of Kumis, would be saying that he was a good Muslim, and the common people started to talk about this case. So the judge, finally, when he goes to the palace, he never meets the ruler, which is interesting. It's all the time through a page. At the end, he proves that Kumis was a Muslim, and therefore that he has to be inherited as a Muslim. Then the fourth text is about Ben Hafsun. While the story of Kumis Ben Antunian is taking place, Ben Hafsun is rebelling. He had also been in Cordoba. He is said to have paid obedience to the Abbasids, to the Fatimids, to have converted to Christianity, to have come back to the obedience of the Umayyad Emir. So Ibn Hafsun is a movable character. He seems to be doing many things through his life, trying to find different ways in which to help his own cause. This is also the period of the martyrs that have been mentioned before. And I would like to say here that one of the explanations among these voluntary martyrs in Cordoba, first of all, they happen in Cordoba, most of them. There are a few, but most of them happen in Cordoba. And in Cordoba is the place where the degree of Arabization and Islamization, of course, is much stronger. And many of them are monks. So some of the scholars who have dealt with the movement say, well, probably these monasteries around Cordoba were seeing the basis for their patronage being shrinking. And they were losing patrons and they were losing customers. So they really were the ones which were being affected by what was going on in Cordoba. Another thing is that and I don't think so few, as you mentioned in your, sorry, I'm going to say this because I'm leaving after my talk, so I just wanted, I think there is, I mean, there are not many, but there is a sizable number of the martyrs who come from mixed marriages. I don't remember how many, but I think at least almost 10 of them come from mixed marriages. And what seems to be going on, as you mentioned in your paper, is that they have been raised as Christians, and for some time that was not a problem, and suddenly it becomes a problem. Now, why does it become a problem? I think it becomes a problem because this is happening at the time in which we really start to get a feeling that there are judges and fukaha everywhere, especially fukaha in Cordoba. You don't get many juries before. This is the period in which they start to flourish. And this is the period when, in order to impose Islamic law, you need agents of Islamic law who impose it, who know it and who impose it. And the impression one gets is that with the numbers, the increasing number of fukaha, things that had gone unnoticed or had not created any problem before, start becoming a problem at this point. Now, we know from a source about Sicily, around some decades later, a traveler who goes to Sicily and says, well, in this part of Sicily, there are this Muslim community in which when a Muslim man marries a Christian woman, the boys are Muslims, but the girls are Christians. And one gets the idea that this transitional adaptation must have been more widespread in the early period than we think of. We get this information for Sicily because a traveler goes there who tries to show how bad Muslims they are. But we don't have this information for Al-Andalus, but to me it makes sense. Because it seems to me to be a logical way of arranging things. Not so long ago, in London, I was staying in a residence for women, and I was having breakfast with an Indonesian Muslim woman and a Sudanese Muslim woman. And the Sudanese and the Indonesian woman was saying, my father is a Muslim. And the Sudanese woman says, then you are a Muslim. And she said, no, I'm a Christian, because my father is a Muslim, my mother is a Christian, and they made the arrangement that the boys would be Muslims and the girls would be Christians. So I don't know how widespread this is in Indonesia. The Sudanese woman, of course, couldn't understand that that was possible, and she was very shocked. But the Indonesian woman thought that that was quite normal.
Which school are they?
Sorry?
Which school, madam?
In where?
The Sudanese woman.
She, I don't know, she would be Maliki, Shafi, I don't know. I don't know, I didn't ask. She was really shocked by the whole story. Okay, so in the case of Ben Hafsun, only this, there is only a source which is written by a court secretary who says that the corpse was exhumated and they found that he had been buried as a Christian. Other sources don't tell us this, and this has been doubted as a way of making Ben Hafsun really the proof that Abderrahman III had managed to get to pacify Al-Andalus and to get rid of all the bad Muslims and all the apostates and all the heretics. So, of course, having Umar Ben Hafsun having died as a Christian is very important for some traditional nationalistic scholars in Spain today. Umar Ben Hafsun is the hero of those who think that there was resistance of the Christians of Al-Andalus against Islamization, and there was not only resistance through martyrdom but also through taking up the arms, and they don't like seeing Ben Hafsun being portrayed as a bandit, like Dozi said, for example. In his, so he's a very controversial figure, and for some, the fact that he died as a Christian is very important. He has statues in many places, in some places in Spain, and poems and theater works have been written about them. My impression is that this is not very trustworthy. That he was a Christian at a certain point, I have no doubt. In his fortress in Bobastro, he built churches. He had a bishop and he built churches, new churches there. So his base was, his followers had many Christians among them. But as you can see from this church, it looks very much like he's imitating the mosque of Cordoba with the arches. And finally, the last text is, comes from a legal work precisely of this same time, although the authority which is quoted is an Egyptian, but the text, this is found in a legal compilation of a Cordoban author who lives around this same time, in which we find many stories that have to do with conversion and how to know who is a convert. There are many texts dealing, for example, what about the children, the different situations in which children can be found, if they were born outside the territory of Islam or inside, whether their parents were captives or not captives. And one is this is one of the stories of, and in the commentary which was written 2 centuries later by the grandfather of Averroes, he says, well, many Christians circumcise themselves. And that we know also from another text in this same compilation, in which a Christian is circumcising his son and he invites his Muslim neighbors, and the question, the legal question is, should we attend the circumcision of the son of the Christian? So while writing this, he also knew that a circumcised man could also be a Christian. So I think this took my time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maribel. We now turn to the respondents, and the first respondent is Professor Yaakov Lev, Professor of Islamic Medieval History at the Department of Middle Eastern Studies at Bar-Ilan University. Most of his work focuses on socio-economic history, part of it Ayyubid and periods in Egypt and Syria, and his current research deals with the administration of justice in medieval Egypt. Professor Lev has published numerous articles and several books and edited volumes, and his last published paper appeared in Jerusalem Studies in Arabic and Islam, and it deals with the conversion of Egypt.
Thank you.
And there is a handout.
Pardon?
There is a handout, right?
Yes, I distributed it. There is a remarkable correlation between the title of our session and Maribel's paper, and we got an answer who is a convert. And then, yes.
The handout is in Arabic. Does anyone who knows Arabic doesn't have a handout?
Look.
I have. Are there extras for them?
Here we go.
So there is a remarkable correlation between the title of our session and the papers and the paper presented by Maribel, and we got an answer. And actually I feel that the text presented don't need any comments except perhaps for text number 2, dealing with the executions of prisoners. It is an unusual text in my view, and it needs a context. And context that I would like to suggest is a wider Islamic medieval warfare and military history. And actually, the discussion began yesterday with the case presented and discussed by Michael Lecker. Yes, executions of the men and capturing of women and children was part of medieval warfare, in some cases at least. I am familiar at least with one almost systematical application of such a type of warfare, and it took place during the Bedouin rebellion against the Fatimid state between 1024-1029 in Palestine and Syria. The Fatimid armies who fought the rebels, Banu Jarrah mostly, systematically attacked the camps, killed the men, captured the men, the women and the children, endangering not just the social fabric of the Banu Jarrah, but actually their very existence. But this type of warfare actually it brought them, after 4 years of heavy fighting, the victory. Otherwise, execution of captured prisoner is quite rare. There are two infamous cases during the Wars of the Crusades. One is the executions of a few hundred cavalry troopers and a handful of infantry who served as archers after the Battle of Hittin, the defeat of the Franks at Hittin by Saladin. And it was a selective killing because actually the Frankish army collapsed. There were thousands of captured prisoners. They were divided between the troops, sold on the slave markets of Syria. The other case took a few years later when the Franks executed the captured garrison of Acre during the Third Crusade after a negotiation and Saladin's failure to pay a ransom for these 3,000 Kurdish troops. So never an explanation is offered in text describing or reporting these events. And we need to understand the reasons for Saladin's deed or the Franks through the context, the wider context of each case. The text that we have here, text number 2, offers an explanation. And actually, I would say it alludes to what is perceived to be a true Muslim. You cannot acquire Islamic knowledge, learning of the Quran, knowledge of the Quran, in overnight. It needs to be a long process of acquiring Islam, internalization of Islamic knowledge, Quran and Hadith. Only then, if this happens, this type of acquired learning happens, you are a Muslim. And if I understand correctly the hidden subtext of the text, actually I think I have two other texts that convey the same message. And the text brings me back to fight with history. The historian is Musabahi, died 1029, and he describes the events that took place in the year 415 Hijri, it means 1024, 1025, as an aftermath of the reign of the Fatimid Caliph al-Hakim during the first two decades of 11th century in Egypt, Syria, and Palestine and Syria. During the time of al-Hakim, there was a forced conversion of Christians and Jews, destruction of churches, monasteries, synagogues in Egypt, in Jerusalem, in Syria, and then a reverse of policy and allowing the Christians to return to Christianity. The Christian who converted to Islam returned to Christianity. There was a need to find a legal device how to do it. The device was found, it took place. But some cases of return took place later on, and Musabihi describes two such cases taking place in the year 1415, it means 1025. The first case is that a reciter of Quran in the ancient mosque in Fustat came to the chief of the lower police. The strange Arabic term Shurta Sufla refers to the police of Fustat. At that time there were two police forces in the capital, one in Cairo called Shurta Ula and one in Fustat, the one here, Shurta Sufla. And they came to the chief of police in Fustat and said, this man, Abu Zakaria, he was a Christian, he converted to Islam, he studied prophetic traditions, he read the Quran, he stayed in the mosque, he performed a Hajj to Mecca, and then he relinquished Islam, saying, and I don't hear the translation suggested by me, to me by John Nawaz, I was bewitched by your prophet. And now the black magic gone, I am back a Christian. And he was considered as one who committed irtidad and executed. In the same year, another Christian, a young man who also adopted Islam, converted, performed the Hajj and raised two daughters as Muslims, he committed irtidad and was executed. So we have a link, I would suggest, between text number two and the perception how Islamic identity is acquired. However, there is text number three in Musabihi, and it deals with something completely different. A person from Aden also died in the same year, 415. We don't have his name. And he is referred to as Musliman. His place of where he lived in Fustat is described in some detail. He was very rich. He had slave girls and slaves and property and money. And there was a funeral prayer taking place in the ancient mosque of Ustad, and his inheritance was divided or given to a person who one of his sons married his daughter. I would say that it fits the Islamic law of inheritance by both the Maliki and the Shafi Mazhab. If I am correct, as one, everything goes to the law of inheritance. So he was a Muslim. So what this strange term Muslimani means, and you can find it several times in Musabihi and other sources dealing with the people who converted during Al-Hakim's reign. Some of them were full Muslims. They committed irtidad, therefore they were executed. Some of them lived as Muslims / Muslimani. They died as a Muslim. There was funeral prayers in the ancient mosque of Ustad, going back to the period of the establishment of Ustad as a Misr by Omar ibn As, and the inheritance was divided according to Islamic laws. And now I like to go to the area of speculations. Apparently, I would say that Muslimani is some kind of adopting Islam, but without any deep or real sense of living as a Muslim. I ask myself, the minimum you need to do as a Muslimani? Perhaps go once for the Friday prayers at the mosque. That's it. You are a Muslim, not a Muslim of the type of these two persons who committed irtidad. It is enough for a court witness to marry his son to one of his daughters, to be buried according to Islamic law, and the inheritance to be divided according to Islamic law. But the person is known as somebody who is, I don't know how to call it, half Muslim, minimal Muslim, Muslimani. And if somebody has any other suggestion about the meaning of Muslimani, it's most welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yaakov. Our second respondent is Professor Elisheva Baumgarten, who holds the Professor Yitzhak Becker Chair of Jewish Studies and teaches in the Department of Jewish History and the Department of History at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Professor Baumgarten is a social historian who studies the Jews of medieval Germany and northern France in the High Middle Ages. Among her publications are Mothers and Children, Jewish Family Life in Medieval Ashkenaz, Princeton University Press 2004, Practicing Piety in Medieval Ashkenaz, Men, Women, and Everyday Jewish Observance, University of Pennsylvania Press 2014, and most recently a co-edited volume with Judy Galinsky, Jews and Christians in 13th Century France, Palgrave 2015. And she's currently working on a social history of medieval Jewish marriage.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this invitation. I'm going to be very short on stating how much of an outsider I am to the field and how far it is from my interest, so I won't apologize anymore for what I don't know. Please just take it as granted. And what I want to do with these texts is really talk about some of their features and pose two questions or two challenges to them. So I think all these texts that we've been presented share an important feature, which is how can one recognize that one is truly converted? When do we know if someone is pretending or if they are actually now Muslim? And the different texts suggest a few different ways. The first text suggests outward appearance, the shaven heads or the shaven faces. The second text suggests knowledge, the knowledge of Quran. And the last three texts show us how much more complicated this was, whether you have previous births, so you have a Christian background to you, whether you're buried in a certain way, or even questioning what happens when you die and you go to another world, how you see yourself in that world in different ways. So I want to make two points about these different texts and hope that they will open up some discussion afterwards. The first is to question how we can look at these converts and the symbols of their conversion when we put them in a broader context of what do those who have not converted, how do they appear, and how do they present these same aspects. So just to try to explain what I mean, the shaven heads are a symbol of the rite de passage. When you're transitioning from being a non-Muslim into being a Muslim, you shave your heads, I'm assuming, and here I'm asking that afterwards you will not look this way, even if you don't look like the way you looked before. And this is both a question and a statement. And this is part of a liminal stage. So the same goes for knowledge. Are we talking about a minimum of knowledge when this man is asking them to quote the Hadith and the Quran? How would this be different if you were asking a full-fledged, a born Muslim to talk about the same knowledge? And the last thing I would say is, what does this mean about the afterlife, which is part of the theological outlook or the view of these people? Are converts still marked in heaven? How long does this mark of conversion stay with them? And I think if we think about these converts and these outward symbols, or these possibilities of pretending, we have to ask, how would these same symbols or markers or attributes mark someone who was Muslim from birth, or Christian from birth, or Jewish from birth, in whatever religion we're talking about? So that's one question I want to pose to these texts. The second question I want to pose to these texts, and here I apologize for being predictable, but it is what I know how to do better than to talk about these texts that are far from my field, is the question of gender. And I want to talk about what these texts can tell us if we bring in the factor of gender and look at them. So I know we have a whole session that will be devoted to women as converts in this conference, and I'm sorry that I won't be able to be here because of teaching obligations on Thursday, but I did want to look at the text that Professor Fierro brought and ask the question of gender, and I think in her remarks she already touched on some of the issues that I want to question and ask here. So these texts, on the whole, present the men, and the women belong to the men. When the men convert, the women go with them. This is very obvious in a tribal context, but we can ask about this also in more individual ways. In the first text Professor Fierro brought us, we have shaved beards and shaved heads, a very male feature. But I know from two of the scholars who belong to this I Corps that actually shaved heads are part of a female conversion process, at least when Jews convert from Christianity to Judaism, from Christianity to Islam, from Judaism to Islam, back and forth. And Moshe Yagur has taught me this from his text from the Gemiza, which have to do mainly with servants who are converting to Judaism after they've been living in the homes of Jewish men and they become part of their families. And Avital Davidovich has been trying to convince me for years that the case of the beautiful captive woman in the Bible is really very interesting in medieval texts. Maybe I'm starting to be convinced. So I think both of them have shown me how central a feature this is in gendered terms. And here we have to ask about these outward gender symbols. So what did the women do? Did they undergo the same procedure as the men? Did they look newly converted, just like the men did? What specific ways were there to mark conversion on women in these same periods and in these same texts? Do we posit that women are always part of whatever religion the men took upon themselves? And I think even in your own example now, the boys will be like the mother, and the girls, like the father, I'm sorry, and the girls will be like the mother. Or as we can see in the third text where they say, well, his mother was a Christian, we can see that this too is doubted. And we don't need to assume that what we see in text number two, in which we have this cruel conversion, all the children and all the women just automatically go along with the men. So I'd like to ask about that. And I think the question of going to heaven or life after death and the way to which these women become part of the new religion they belong to, once again, is something that can be questioned. And in order to perhaps talk about that, I brought you the text I gave you as part of the handout. And this is a text from a milieu I'm much more familiar with. Here, there's some for you here. And if anyone doesn't have, maybe we can share. I hope enough for photocopied. And part of the Hebrew is up there. I'm sorry that I cut it by accident last night, so you only have part of the translation. I mean, the translation is fuller than the text you have up on the screen, and I apologize for that. So why did I think this text was appropriate? This text is from Sefer Chassidim, late 12th, early 13th century composition from northern Germany. And it talks about women in exactly the situation that I've been trying to present to you in different ways. In other words, these are women who were converted, but they didn't want to convert. So they are pretending to be Christian, although they are actually staying Jewish. And they might be an interesting example of how we could problematize some of the texts we've seen here about Muslim conversions. And this is what we hear. During the time of persecution, some were killed, and some converted with the intention of returning to the Jewish religion when they would have the opportunity. Rather, because of their fear of the sword, they converted. This is internal Jewish apologetics. They're just explaining why these women actually converted to Christianity. I think we can ignore this part of the apologetics at the beginning. So now we go and see how important, when we're talking about gender, is a question that we didn't think about all so much for the men, and that is personal status. Are these women married? Are they on their own? What does it mean, this kind of question of personal status? And that's something I would once again ask back at the Muslim text. How do the outward appearances of conversion manifest themselves depending on personal status and not just on gender? So we hear the women whose husbands were killed or who were single, some said they should convert, they should, some said lest the uncircumcised contaminate them. And they were so scared they would be somehow physically contaminated and they would be raped by the non-Jews that they decide that they want to go to the convent. Now I think this question of physically marking, and even beyond the physically, we can see a little bit in the question of circumcision, how the physical mark manifests itself on the convert. And in this case, we have these women who say they wish to become priestesses. Now I know that's terrible English, but the Hebrew word is komrot, so I left it as priestesses. And I think this is really interesting to show us that we don't quite have the terminology of nuns at this time, and that's why they call the convent the komria, which is just a kind of use of the male Hebrew word of komer. So I just thought that was interesting, and that's why I left the translation in this way. So the women decide that they don't want to be marked physically, and they don't want to be contaminated, and they don't want to be, their personal status should not be changed, and they decide to go to the convent. But young females they did not send there, because they said if they escaped, they would not leave the young ones with them. In other words, they're afraid that if they go to the convent, they'll have to leave the young girls there. So one option is to go to the convent. Others wore black clothes in their homes. And here we can see another way of manifesting conversion, which is the clothing that's worn, and that's not at all in the text that we read now, but I would be very interested in hearing more about how conversion was shown in clothing and by clothing. And we also see a very intimate knowledge of the codes of Christian society, because these women are now dressing like beguines, if we use medieval terminology, and they're wearing black clothing. And this is because they realize that if they would become nuns, they wouldn't be able to escape. Now, what we also have here very nicely is the response of the other side. So the Christians say to them, either you should be in the woman's home or you should wear white clothes. And they wore white clothes. So either go to the convent or become another kind of Christian woman, become fille de Dieu, if you wish, 13th century religious women who wore white and were somewhat more policed and under supervision. And they wore white clothes. Because they, the Jewish women, said, perhaps if we are in the Komriya, we will not be able to escape. And those who were wise among them, the Nashim Chachamot, said, if they are contaminated against their will by way of prostitution, it is not as grave a sin as those who are in the convent or the Komriya, who are guarded for a number of years so that they do not escape, and who eat impure food and desecrate the Sabbath. So I want to just kind of make a very broad comparison between the desecrating the Sabbath here, or eating impure food, to, let's say, having the knowledge or lacking the knowledge of the other religion, although it's not such a good comparison here. And they go on and conclude that if the uncircumcised urge them to marry an uncircumcised man, she will not be able to escape from her husband who guards her, so it is better that she be in the Komriya and not be contaminated by the uncircumcised. So what we have here in the text are a lot of the different considerations that gender makes us take into account when we talk about conversion and we talk about religious knowledge and religious identification. But we also have here the ability to pretend to be of the other religion and to pretend to look like the other religion, to even act like the other religion, and have that basic knowledge, and perhaps in the world to come, after death, to go back to the original religion, as we saw in some of these examples. So if I try to sum up this example I brought here, and try to relate to the text that we're discussing this session, I wanted to problematize, on the one hand, the credibility of outward appearance, the credibility of knowledge, the credibility even of what this person intends in the world to come after death. But at the same time as I'm problematizing these things, I also wanted to point to the necessity of them, how important they are, these outward symbols, this kind of basic knowledge that you expect everyone to have as a kind of minimum. And when we bring gender into the story, I think we can find many different variations and many different beliefs over time and in different places of how these different issues play out against each other. So I end here by saying once again that these texts are not texts that I'm familiar with, but I think they show in a very important and interesting way how central all these questions are of marking on the body, marking the outward appearance, marking even temporarily on the body, like the shaven heads, and perhaps how when we talk about men and women, these things can be done differently. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Maribel, you want to respond?
Yeah. I agree with, the text that were brought by Jacob are very interesting for me and very important, and this matter of the minimal Muslim, as you say, because I think in the case of Hashim Ben Abdelaziz, he's, had he done the same that he was doing with the men of the fortress in Cordoba, with families of all Muslims, he might have got the same reaction. People who didn't have much hadith, and people who didn't know much, also would stammer reading the Quran. Because at the, just 4 decades before he's doing this, we have stories telling us that some people who are going to become scholars realize that they don't have hadith in Al-Andalus, and they go to the East in search for hadith. So the hadith is just being introduced in Al-Andalus 3 or 4 decades before. So how are you going to expect a person in a fortress to know any hadith? I mean, Hashim is being very evil. He's playing tricks on them and pretending that that's the way they should be as Muslims. Whereas most Muslims at that time in Al-Andalus probably had very little Quran and no hadith at all. I mean, the scholars didn't have much hadith at this time of Islamization of Al-Andalus. So he's being extremely evil in what he's putting very up the requirement for being a Muslim. And that's the reason that the God-fearing Muslims know that he's not behaving well, because nobody would expect from a Muslim of this, a normal Muslim at that time, to have the knowledge that he's requiring from those people in the fortress.
When the text is written?
The text is, this is a text written, most of these texts come from a century after and written in the Caliphal court of Cordoba. And as I say, Hashim is the body of this story in which the emir, the Umayyad emirs are always trying to open the room for new converts, and it's the bad Umayyad Mawali who are trying to keep it closed. So in a way, Hashim is being constructed as the real bad, and this is one of the examples. So who knows? Maybe it happened. I don't know if he would have gone to such a sophisticated thing to do. Why to waste so much time asking them for Quranic verses and for hadiths? I mean, the whole story is a bit odd. It's a bit odd.
Perhaps it is a late attempt of justification of his deeds, but it reflects the perception of what is a true Muslim at the time the text was written.
Yes. Doesn't make much sense for his own times.
No.
Yeah. And
which brings him closer to the Muslim.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. In terms of time.
And for the women, probably in the text, in the Christian text about these women who become martyrs, maybe we can take from this information about the way they dress and the way they behave and things like that. I don't think that has been done. So this is one thing that that could be done. But I cannot recall in any of the Arabic sources with which I am familiar any story similar to this text that you have. The only story I can think of is when some Ibadi women in North Africa are defeated by a soul. There is a rebellion of Ibadis, and the men are defeated by the Sunnis, and the women are taken captives. And one of the old women tell the women, "Don't worry, this is like a marriage for you." So she gives them, it's an old woman like this, finds a solution for them, because she said they felt terribly distressed and they were very anxious, so she gave them this solution for their plight. It's not like it's like a marriage. It's not a legal marriage for you. But,
okay. Yes.
Thank you very much. Just three very brief comments and a question. So the case of the Christian secretary who converts, I mean, the sentence here that if only the count were a Muslim, I would appoint him secretary. I mean, this is Ibn Kilis. It's just, it sounds word by word almost with Kafur al-Rashidi. So Mark, you know about that very well. And that's related, I think you're spot on with Musulmani. Tamer al-Laythi dealt with some length with the topic with reference to converts to Islam, officials who converted to Islam in the Mamluk period, Christian officials converting to Islam, and depicted in biographic dictionaries as Musulmanis as a degrading title, suggesting that they were crypto Muslims or crypto Christians, depending from which side you're looking. The fact that the rest of their family members remained Christian, the fact that they were practicing Christianity inside their home, that was always came together with Musulmani. I think that should be, that's worth considering. And then, of course, the issue of girls remaining in the side of the religion of their mothers and boys in the side of their fathers. This is a tradition that is always often attributed to second caliph Umar. It is a treaty with Banu Taghlib that is mentioned in Kitab al-Kharaj, and also Ahmad ibn Hanbal refers to it in his responsa, that the agreement was, I'm sorry, this is not the story I was referring to somewhere. It is mentioned by Ahmad with reference to an agreement between two tribes, I believe. Maybe Luke remembers this better than I do. Mentioned in the Abu Bakr al-Khalal's collection, where there is an agreement that the children born to a mixed marriage couple, if they are born, the males will be Muslims, the daughters will be Christian. That was the agreement that was signed between the two parties. So there's an earlier tradition to this. Now the question that I have is really, I'm not really clear what's going on in text number two. The rebels, question, who are these rebels? And what kind of rebels are these? Are they political rebels? Are they religious rebels? Are they, in the sense, religious rebels, so considered apostates? That's one question mark that I have. And then they hurried to leave with their children and families and moved to the military camp of the Sultan. He gathered them and then he questioned them, are you a Muslim or a non-Arab? Ajami. And you're saying Ajami can refer also to a non-Muslim. You said that. So is the question at stake, is the issue at stake here, whether are you Muslim or non-Muslim, or are you Muslim of Arab descent or Muslim of non-Arab descent? I'm not clear what's going on here. And so I think it has different significance depending on the question, on the answer. And also that would be interesting, again, depending on your answer, what kind of, what's the differentiation here between the Muslim and the Ajami in terms of the kind of questioning then that is posed to them with regard to their knowledge of Islam, assuming that a Muslim Arab would have better knowledge of Islam. Mm-hmm. Or I mean, these are things that could be asked also in the context of the eastern part of the Mediterranean, where Muslims of Arab descent or Arabic background, it's difficult to talk about Arabs, were presumed to be superior in their knowledge of Islam. Is this what's going on here? So that's my question. So who are the rebels and what's this differentiation?
Well, the rebels, as I said, are Muwalladun, is a Muwallad rebel in one of the areas of, that means that the rebel is a non-Arab who has rebelled against the Umayyads. Now, this Muwalladun...
But he's a Muslim.
As I said, usually Muwalladun is understood as meaning a convert. I'm not so clear about this. I think Muwalladun is a term that is being used because it's not clear if at certain points they are Muslims and at certain point they are not Muslims, like Ben Hafsun, who is one of these Muwalladun who converts to Christianity at a certain point. He's born as a Muslim, but at a certain moment of his rebellion, he converts to Christianity and starts building churches, like the one I show in Bobastro. So usually Muwalladun has been understood as meaning converts, of recent converts, local converts who have just converted to Islam without wala, with an Arab tribe. Mm-hmm. So another kind of conversion. They are not converting, becoming members of Arab tribes, and this is another issue. So these Muwalladun are Arabized people, are Arabized lords, local people who have become Arabized. Whether they have become Islamized or not, that's some people would say yes, and I would say I don't know.
But their children are considered Muslim.
Some of them are considered, well, the whole text is about this. Are they Muslims or are they not Muslims?
But the children of those who've been executed.
By some God-fearing Muslims who decide, they say some of them are Muslims. So these are Muwalladun. Now, there is an influential historian in Spain who recently died who said, these Muwalladun represent the old Visigothic lords who at this point of time are losing their lands and they are losing their people through conversion and they are getting very angry and they are rebelling because they want to keep their feudal ways. Because the Cordovan state is expanding and is imposing what they call, this a Marxist historian, the Islamic social formation. So what we are witnessing in the Fitna is the rebellion of the descendants of the old Visigothic lords. Until that time, they have managed to preserve, extract rent and to keep their control of their men. Now they are losing it and they rebel because they want to keep it. And some Arabs and some Berber lords are thinking, oh, this is a good idea, we'll do the same. Okay? So if you take this, if you accept this, then it's the fact that Umar bin Hafsun at a certain point converts to Christianity makes sense because he's the most important of these rebels. He has managed to get hold of several fortresses, quite impregnable, like Bobastro. He seems to be able to defeat the armies and he converts to Christianity because some of his followers are Christians and he has bishops and what he needs to is what he's trying to do is to keep the old ways and for that he needs Christianity because Islam comes with a different economic system. He won't be able to keep that control of his men through Islam, so who converts to Christianity. He later converts back to Islam because he's defeated and he makes an amal with the emir, and he seems to be a Muslim at this point. So he's moving back and forth. And probably some of the other Muwallad lords are also, that's the reason they are called Muwalladun, I think, because they don't, I also think they are called Muwalladun, I don't want to be too, because this is a long story, because these are chronicles that are written in the 10th century when the caliphate has been established, the old economic system has disappeared, and now Islam reigns supreme. And what the Umayyads are doing is trying to obliterate the memory of the fact that the land was conquered by Arabs who created their own Mawali. And the Umayyads at this point don't want the Arabs to have any power and any privilege, and they don't want them to have Mawali. So Mawali are only Umayyad Mawali. So how to call these men? They call them Muwalladun in the chronicles. Probably some of them were Mawali of the Arab tribes who have settled in the lands where they are acting. But this is a memory that the Umayyad court historians don't want to keep. So, because suddenly we don't have Mawali in Al-Andalus, but there must have been Mawali. I mean, Musa ben Musayl had Mawali, Yusuf al-Fihri had Mawali, they had Mawalis, but suddenly they disappear from the scene and we get the Muwalladun. So I think this is the point of view of the Umayyad pro-Umayyad historians.
Okay, welcome.
Yeah.
Questions?
Sorry, I don't know if I answered. Yeah.
I just want to ask about
Hashim. Oh, and the whole story here is because Hashim, all the time, the way he appears in the sources is because he's a Mawla, but he feels that he's an Arab. So for him, Arab and Islam goes together. And all the time what he's trying is to say, if you are not an Arab, you are a suspect as a Muslim. That's the whole story. That's what he's trying to do with his the use of the language. You are an Ajam, therefore, your Islam is suspect. Only we, the Arabs, are entitled to have privileges and to consider ourselves Muslims.
Can we say that the first text is a Khariji text? It's a Khariji source?
Yes.
The Khawarij used to shave off their heads. And this is in continuation of the pre-Islamic.
But they did it for a different reason, not different from this one.
It expressed their preparedness to die in battle. And this is a continuation of pre-Islamic practice. I wonder about the second text. Why does Rukub prevent the Khatib from continuing traveling? Or is it Mawkib, perhaps? What is Rukub to do? What does it have to do with Kitaba? Okay, an open question.
And I think he needed to be a horseman because he was also, he had to go with the emir wherever he went, taking notes.
Not connected to the Mawkib? The procession. And 3b, Taraja'a, I believe it's to say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. I just want to bring up a question that I feel that is coming up in our discussion in the group, and I think these texts are beautifully showing, and this is the need to talk about power and conversion or the question that arises from our definition of what is exactly forced conversion, because the text that you are bringing and also the text that Elisheva brought, I think shows how we need maybe more subtle tools when dealing with the question of what exactly is forced conversion and what is forced. And I think that the question of gender also come here because there are different forces that are inflicted upon men and upon women. And there's, when we're talking about violence, so these are different sorts of violence. We have gender-based violence that is different for men and women. And also the question of the bigger question of power is the question of who gets to define the convert, and that comes to the way people are marked. So who gets to mark Are you marking yourself like these women in the Jewish example, or are you being marked by the others? So these are just, I just want to put these questions and to see if you have any thoughts about it.
I completely agree. As I said, what Hashim is doing is imposing his own what benefits him of what a Muslim is. And I think the text recognizes it when at the end it said there were some Muslims who did not agree with what he was doing because he had his own agenda. And how would we know how a convert at this period, in this 9th century, which is very interesting because everything I think is in flux, would define himself as being a Muslim? I think that in most cases, and in that I think I didn't not agree with something that you said, there were really no minimal, it was very minimal. I mean, minimal Muslims were the majority at this time of the history of Al-Andalus. Nobody was there, and there was nobody there. There were no muqtasibs trying to inquire how big your Islam was. We get the muqtasib in the case of Qumis because there is a big fortune there involved, and because there are some people who want to make fuss about it. But in most cases, there was nobody interested in going there and inquire how good Muslim you are. And I think that was the highest percentage of the experience of Muslims at this time. These were very relaxed Muslims. They had their, for some different reasons, they were considered Muslims, because they were born out of a father who was Muslim because they had said the Shahada, and nobody was there to inquire. There was no tradition going to ask you how inside you were a comfortable. And I think that was the things happened. It was the long run. There was the scholars, I don't think the Muslim scholars, at least the Muslim scholars that I know, they were not interested in pressing this process of conversion, making it in short at the short term, not the middle term, it was a long term for them. Slowly it would happen.
But isn't the marking itself is a violent way of sort of making your conversion visible so we can follow you or track you, or we will know that you're different than the others. That you're not part of the, or not a full part, or not a full member yet of that community.
Yeah, that's the reason in the history of Qumis, the common people start talking about the fact. I think the fact that Qumis was suspected, a man who went to the mosque and prayed, and suddenly someone was saying he's not a Muslim, and therefore he's cannot be inherited by his sons, the common people started talking about this, because that affected them. I mean, is this going to happen to all of us? Now there is going to be a Muqtasib coming and ask us if we are really Muslims or not, and the judge doesn't go that way. I don't know if you want to read
it? The Christian Arabic and the Muslim text referring to the persecutions of Al-Hakim single out two breaking points. One is for the officials, Christian and mostly Christians employed in the Fatimid states. They converted because they wanted to keep their positions. The simple people converted because they were obliged to wear the riyar. It means the color and the distinctive garments. In order to avoid the riyar, Christian and Jewish communities converted to Islam, and they wanted to relinquish Islam and the later ramification of the event. But there are at least two breaking points, completely different from the officials and from the simple people.
Yeah, that's the difference between the experience that he's talking about and what I'm talking about. Here there is no forced conversion at all. I mean, there was never forced conversion in Al-Andalus as far as we know. I mean, it's something that is happening, and more as a sociological phenomenon than any other thing. In his case, there is a forced conversion. So that makes a lot of a difference in the reaction.
I'm just referring to the fact that I'm taking that when we're talking, usually when we're generally talking about forced conversion, we mean that the conversions were somehow made by force, so, or that the person was threatened enough in order to convert. But I'm just alluding to the fact that there are different ways of power. For example, if a husband converts and the wife needs to convert with him against her will, this will be a forced conversion.
Yeah, okay.
But we will probably want refer to that as forced conversion, or at least we want to find it in our sources. So I'm just bringing it up in order to think about the fact that conversion itself is, if we think about it, is a very violent act, or a very, at least, transformative, dramatic act. So I think there are more ways of violence and power that you can talk about it than just, you know, to threat someone's life. And it will still be forced in a way, in the sense that the were forces that working in order to...
Okay. Yeah, there is other questions, so perhaps...
That's it, I don't want
to... Okay. We don't have sources that tell us about this happening in a dramatic way. So maybe it's a problem of the sources that we have, and we'll never recover that, how dramatic it was. Another possibility is that it was not so dramatic, because it happened in a very slow process and becoming minimal Muslim and keeping very much of the markers of the cultural and other things that allow you to not to feel it as traumatic. But this can be discussed, of course.
I just had one remark on this formula where the text number 2 is talking about are you a Muslim or an adjunct. It's actually something that is not unusual. We find there's a papyrus from Egypt where it is mentioned, and you have a list of systems for the suite of archivists and the governor of Egypt in the early decades of the 8th century, and it is said that this suite is composed of Arabs and Christians. This is a Greek text, a Greek papyrus. And I actually, when I came to Israel a few days ago, I actually thought I finally understood how this can be used when I came here, and I was told, well, that the Israeli population is composed of Jews and Arabs. That's also something that people just use those categories, and that's not actually unusual. And the other thing I thought about between this, what was said about what you said, Maribel, about Mualladun, I found was very interesting, and it actually mirrors quite well, I think, what you're presenting here about the Muslim many, because those are both terms that are used only in certain regions. So the first one in Iran, the second one in Egypt. And I was thinking for bringing this about what a forced conversion is, because if Tamar Alex is understanding the Muslimani as someone who was forced to be converted, again, it depends on what you mean by forced conversion. Because, for instance, what we have in the text 3, well, this Christian official, in a sense, he's forced to convert if he wants to go be higher in the administrative hierarchy. So, I mean, I think we will keep struggling in defining those terms if we don't see this category of something between a Muslim and a Christian as not as inclusive as possible. I think it's inclusive of a lot of status in between something between Muslim and Christian.
Thank you.
Thank you for this wonderful panel. They're wonderful texts. Just two quick comments. One to Elie Shaver's comment. There's an interesting, just a little detail in the Court of a Martyr text that talk about conversion in women and clothes. There are two women, both born to religiously mixed families. Their names are Viliosa and Savigotha. And the way that they announce their apostasy, the fact that, contrary to what everyone else thinks about them, that they're Muslims, that in fact they're Christians, the way that they announce that to the world is by entering a church and unveiling. So just a small little detail. And then to Maribel's comments, I found the text about Ibn al-Tunayn very interesting. I just want to flag another one you probably know about. There's a dispute as to whether or not he is also represented in the Court of a Martyr texts. According to Eulogius, the biographer, Muhammad ibn Abd al-Rahman issues an edict shortly after assuming office that bans Christians from serving in the state, and there is an unnamed Christian official, often thought to be Ibn Battuta, who apostatizes. He converts from Christianity to Islam in order to preserve his status, and he's just completely condemned and reviled by this hardcore of Christian authors. And so it's not a 100% identification, but I think most people would like to see them. And it backs into a larger issue of a caricature of these aristocratic members. When Christians write about them, they're truly the scum of the earth. They don't have much patience for those who leave Christianity, period. But these types of people, the heads of the Christian community, who, in order to preserve their status, go over to Islam, they earn this special review. And so interesting to see on the Christian and Muslim side, some sort of maybe communication about this character and how he's represented.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that one of the interesting points that came up from the text and some extent the discussion around it is one of the acculturation, and that is something that he actually, the text cites, and that is that the Talmud is eloquent in Arabic, and the other place he's called, mentions his ability, his merits of his adab become manifest. You know, in a number of places, it speaks about the fact that he's well acquainted with the norms of behavior and forms of knowledge, and therefore he can easily convert. Now, how serious that conversion is a good question, but this brings up the issue of acculturation and Islamization, and it brings up the issue, in my opinion, again, of process. In other words, there are different sorts of processes leading up to Islamization. And I think it's quite relevant to elites, especially when we talk about elites, where they sort of meld together, and at a certain point, from whatever personal point of view, you decide to convert. But there's a long lead up to this conversion. So if you can say something about that. And then you just mentioned something which I thought was very important when discussing force, and that is that they convert, but then there is a process of social conversion, in the sense that it first, at the beginning, it's nominal, and then there's a process where they can go through on an individual level or from generation to generation, and gradually the Islamization becomes much more powerful. And we see that also in Indonesia and in Asia, when people convert due to Sufis, they come in contact with Sufis. It's pretty superficial, and that's the way it's seen by many people, including other Muslims that will come there later and try to enhance the Islamic aspect of it. So if you can say something about this process.
Well, I think we can map this process, and with my colleague Manuela Marin, we have tried to do it by mapping at which point we get ulama in a certain region of the Iberian Peninsula. When we start getting, not one or two, but some of them, then we think that area is in the second stage of Islamization, in which minimal Islamization is not enough. Now you have to have Hadith, Quran, and other things. And this happens very slowly. So I would think that until the second half of the 9th century, we are still in the period in which there is the minimal Muslim. Mm-hmm. People who say that they are Muslims. In Cordoba, no. In Cordoba, things are more complicated. I mean, the big towns is more complicated, but in most of the Iberian Peninsula, the majority is still Christian, of course, and where you have Muslims, these are Muslims with minimal requirements. You can also do this with mosques, but this is more complicated. But I think to have scholars is very important. And this is very clear, for example, for what is now Morocco. I mean, in Morocco, you get scholars, you get what you have networks of scholars, and scholars and judges, only from the 11th century onwards.
Arab?
Yes. You cannot find them before. So what do you have before? That's what we are not so much able to recover, because we don't have sources. I mean, the sources, for the sources, you need the scholars. Or you know, with the body case, is different. I'm not dealing with Ibadis now. But in the case of Al-Andalus, we have maps that which we can show this very clearly. So I think numbers of ulama are a very important indication of this. I don't know if people would agree with this or not, but I think this is the way to know. Doesn't mean that before there are no Muslims, but Muslims with Hadith, with Quran, with Fiqh, you need agents.
The presence of mainstream Islamic religious establishment is what you use as an indicator.
Yes.
That's what you're saying.
Also because if you have scholars, they start writing about themselves. You cannot be a scholar if you don't write about who you are. That's the way you are also a scholar. That's the way you prove you are a scholar and that you exist and that you are useful to society and to the and to that person in power. So it goes, it's something that goes together.
The question of acculturations brings me completely different context than the religious persecutions of the Abbasid Caliph al-Mutawakkil. Then, according to the sources, the conversion happened when the acculturation option was closed by the Caliph, who forbid instruction in Arabic in the kutabs of the Zimis. And then they converted to Islam.
Sorry. I'm not really convinced by in these texts, especially 2 and 3, that it's about conversion or conviction of conversion, but rather what Maribel called Hashim's interest. Mm-hmm. I mean, the case of these captives, he wants to make money off of them. And he can't make money off of them if they're Muslims. So he has to convince people, or himself, or the judges, or whoever he thinks he has to give an accounting to, that they're not Muslims. And that's why he kills them off, no matter what they do to prove that they're Muslims. And it's not a question of how acculturated they are, how Islamicized they are. Whatever they do, he's going to kill them because he wants a wife and children. It's only the few his followers who say, you know, this really isn't right, buy the women and children and release them because they realize they're Muslim. And the case of Humis, that he doesn't want this guy to have the job. It interferes with his job. So I see it more as what you saw, his interest. It's more power struggle or even financial. It's his financial interest that they're not be Muslims. And I don't see this has to do with conversion, especially the first number 2.
I think the last day of the conference, it seems that Islam and conversion are coming or going hand in hand. And the question, is it the case? Because at least in Tabari, there are several examples of an opposition against conversion of the local population. It's one. And the second point is Shafi, Dabrum, and others make a clearly differentiate between ethnicity, the Arab, and religion. So there are Arab Muslims and there are Arab Christians. The case of Jonathan is quite well known. And the question is, can we point on the moment when the policy of the state, of the regime, changed and the Islamic regime started to encourage the conversion of the local population?
Okay. In the case of Al-Andalus, we have Arabs, which is a difference, for example, with Morocco, with what is now Morocco. So we have quite a number of Arabs. There are also Berbers, but let's talk about the Arabs. The Arabs are settling on the land. They have no interest whatsoever in having the population convert to Islam, because they are collecting the taxes from the population, and the population, as long as they remain non-Muslims, the more they collect. So the first wave of Arabs and the second wave, which came with the Arab, the Syrian Jews, they had no interest whatsoever of having any conversion of, and they had Mawali, but that was another matter because that increased their power compared to the other tribal groups. So, and they make it very clear. There is a famous anecdote in which one of the Arab lords listens to a teacher teaching a Quranic verse in which it says, I don't remember exactly, but he says, no, but you are getting it wrong because the Anas that is mentioned in this Quranic verse refers only to the Arabs. And the teacher says, the Alim says, no, it refers to Arabs and non-Arabs who are Muslims. And he says, no, no, you got it wrong. It's only us, the Arabs, who want. The Arabs are usually the baddies in all the stories in Al-Andalus. So then they come the Umayyads, and the Umayyads, in order to get power in Cordoba, what they had to do was to take power out of, from the Arabs. They used them in order to get power, but once they got power, the main enemies were the Arabs. So a way to fight against the Arabs and take out from them the privilege was to favor conversion. The Umayyads were in favor that most of the population would convert to Islam because at that time also, these people who converted were not anymore maulas of the Arabs, they were maulas of the whole Muslim community. So that they will increase the Muslim community and they will help the Umayyads if the Umayyads played it right against the Arab lords. So the Umayyads did favor the conversion. And there is also at this moment a shift, especially in the, we see that in Cordoba, in which some of the descendants of the Jews, of the Arab Jews, start to become scholars themselves. And they themselves become Islamized. And they are Muslims, old Muslims, but they are becoming Islamized because they want to learn Hadith and they want to learn fiqh and they go to the East and they come with new ideas and with more the ideas that Islam is universal and is not exclusive to the Arabs. So they start also mining the old privileges of the Arabs. Did I answer your?
Yeah.
And by the 10th century, suppose that with the caliphate, with the proclamation of the caliphate, which the Umayyads are obliged to do in order to counteract the Fatimids in North Africa, they have created the ideal Islamic society in which everybody, all Muslims are equal because they have done with the Arab privileges, which of course was not true, but they started writing chronicles in order to show how bad the Arabs were and how thanks to the Umayyads, these Arab lords and Arab like Hashim, who behaved so badly, were done with because Hashim was executed at the end of the story.
Actually, I have two questions, but they are mostly with details. I'm trying to understand what's going on in the stories, between text 4 and 5. Text 5, as I asked, I said to you before you started, it's a lovely, I think it's a wonderful text, but of course, what happens if they find a woman rather than a man? How do they know? How do they know? How would the person know? But that's not the exact question that I was going to ask. The commentary which talks about Christians having also circumcising themselves, I presume that it must be referring to Mozarabs, so although people live under, because Christians who don't live under Muslim control, it's very, very unlikely that they would circumcise themselves in the flesh.
I don't know if the Christians not living in Muslim lands circumcise themselves.
No, but Christians, do we know about Christians living in Muslim lands?
Yeah, but I don't know if others didn't. I mean, I really don't know because I've learned through the I'm old enough to know that I cannot say this didn't happen. Maybe there was some kind of Jewish trend among some Christians that they do circumcise. I don't know.
Just my intuitive thought would be that just that Christians would internalize Pauline doctrine would never
at
be
no more,
period?
No more.
At this early period?
Yeah.
So there's a very interesting anecdote along these lines in one of these Mozarab authors, Samson, who writes in Latin, in the 860s, immediately after the Cordoba incident, one of these aristocratic convicts that he complains about is an individual named Alphonsus, who is in the milieu of the Umayyad court, and as an old man converts from Christianity to Islam. And one of the things that he attacks him for is circumcising himself. And there's this very kind of grotesque and vivid imagery where he talks about what the procedure is like, what he is endowed with, etc. I recommend you go read it. But it's clear from this that the circumcision is a decisive break. That is to say, as a Christian, he is not circumcised.
Right. Who are these Christians here?
I think in Egypt, I know that in Egypt around this time, there's some evidence of Christians who are circumcising. So it's not Spain, but I think...
Christian, we know about Neophysites in general in the 7th century are still practicing.
Yeah, this is later.
Of course.
Yeah. Also in 12th.
In the Geniza, according to Moshe, it's a testimony.
In the Geniza, there's a letter about some Jewish guy, and he circumcises the Copts. They are Awlad al-Akbat.
Okay, so interesting. And regards to text number 4, I always thought that it might be ignorance. I always thought that the issue of burial was not whether you're on your back or on your front, but which direction the body was facing.
No, it is whether you are on this or on this.
Yeah, so it's not a question of which direction the body is facing?
It's also the direction, but mostly, but you also have to be on your side. You cannot be like this.
We were talking about on the back or on the front, so...
Yeah, but if you are a Muslim, you have to be on...
I have to say that I read this particular text in class where I have 4 Muslim students, and they immediately knew what's going on. So we're safe here.
And all the cemeteries, Muslim cemeteries that have been found in Al-Andalus, it's very clear that they are being put like this.
Regarding the prohibition of Al-Mutawalik you mentioned Al-Mutawalik prohibited to learn Arabic in the Zindi Kitab. So I think that's the strange of the story, isn't it? I mean, here Abu Kura is already, he lived at around 800, and Hunayn ibn Ishaq was the physician at the court of Al-Mutawalik. So, I think, the Christians didn't know Arabic already, they were translating texts into Arabic. So, what is the meaning of the story?
As far as I remember the text dealing with Mutawakkil, there were a number of edicts. The persecution took place, were spread on a number of years. And one of the edicts explicitly said that the prohibition of teaching Christian and Jewish boys in their kutabs in Arabic. They have to switch to the original languages. I think one of the texts says explicitly that they ought to be taught in Hebrew, and the Christian, I don't remember the language is specific. And then converted to Islam because of this specific edict forbidding education in Arabic, which I understand as closing the option of acculturation.
This is an Islamic report?
Yes, it is. Who it is? I can't remember. Ibn Jawzi. I think Muntazam or Sibt Ibn Jawzi. One of these. Sibt or...
Then it must have to do with the reversal of the doctrine of the...
Not Tabar. Certainly not Tabar. Yeah.
Is it
later than Tabar?
No, it's not Tabar.
I was thinking maybe the reversal of the creativeness of the Quran doctrine. Because Abu Tawakkil changed the doctrine that Ma'mun had introduced,
right,
saying that the Quran was created in time. Abu Tawakkil switched sides, said exactly the opposite. It's eternal. It is the word of God.
Right.
Arabic is the language of God, and therefore only Muslims should study the Arabic language. This is a guess. It's just a reversal, a reflection of reversal of policy. I don't think that there'll be much more, because what language were Christians, the original language of Christian, Arab Christians, be Aramaic?
Perhaps, yeah.
Yeah, but Al-Mutawakkil imposed a whole series of edicts on the enemies, not just the prohibition of teaching Arabic to non-Muslims. Also, he said that all these had to be dismissed from there.
I haven't prepared the Mutawakkil case, but as far as I remember, the text says that following this specific edict forbidding the teaching in Zimi Kutabs in Arabic, conversion took place. I'm pretty sure about the connection.
Just briefly about the acculturation. The acculturation that is very clear happening in Al-Andalus in the early in the first century is Arabic acculturation. Mm-hmm. You get poets everywhere. They are, these Muwallad rebels have their own poets making poetry in Arabic for them. So it's the Arabic culture, the Arabic language, the kind of Islamization comes later. First, the acculturation is to Arabic. There are Arabs, and the Arabs attract people who, and the famous, the text that Christian is going to read is complain about the Christians, the loving Arabic poetry.
Yes.
So it's Arab culture that attracts them more than any other thing.
One question here, and then we turn to the backbenchers.
So, thank you. I have a question about marriage. So it seems, Elisheva, from your document that about options of the converts, and it seems in your document like the worst option for the Jewish women is the husband. Okay? It's easier, it's, they say, about the convert, the convent, perhaps we will not be able to escape from the Qumriyah. But to marry an uncircumcised man, she will not be able to escape. I mean, that's the worst case. But on Maribel, your story, what you told, maybe you can elaborate it, on it more. This was, okay, this was a comforting message. Don't worry, it's just marriage. And in the other option, in the other story, it's, oh no, marriage, we better go to the convent. And this brings me to the Muslimani. So let's say that Muslimani is a minimal Muslim. Do we have Muslimania? Is there any sense for a minimal Muslim female, or it doesn't really matter?
Not that I am aware of.
So there, it's not interesting.
Should check the database.
What help you?
Anyone else?
Yeah. If I may say something about the
Moshe, I just want to respond to Moshe. At least historically speaking, I think the question of the woman's identification as a member of a certain religion by marriage or not by, or on her own, is something that changed over time, at least in medieval Europe. It's something that has been documented. Mm-hmm. Shaya Cohen actually showed this very, very nicely around the question of circumcision. It was a source I was playing with bringing into my response, so I can bring it in now, and that is that, at least in the earlier sources, Jews will insist that their women are circumcised, which is the mark of identification with religion, not that they're actually physically circumcised, but that they're circumcised by the merit of the men they belong to. So those men can either be their husbands, their sons, their fathers, most often their husbands. By the time you get to the 12th and 13th century, and actually in that perspective, the text I brought is interesting because it marks a time of transition, that's not enough. So Jewish scholars are looking for a way to say these women are Jewish, they're not marked on their bodies, they're not marked just by marriage, but they have to be marked in some other way. The way they come up with also has marriage involved. So it's interesting that they can't let go of that personal marker. But I think the question of, you know, how is a woman part of the covenant, whatever covenant it may be or whatever religion it may be, is one that changes over time. And I would say, without too much knowledge of the text we're talking about here, that as Islam becomes more entrenched in the different areas, and as it moves from acculturation to Islamization, we'll see a different manifestation of this, although in, you know, each society with its own patriarchal features, it will be manifested differently. So I think that's something to look for, maybe.
And another source that I have not, I could have brought more examples about this. This text from which the last text comes it's a collection of legal questions, and many legal questions have to do. What if a Muslim man is married with a Christian woman? Can she drink wine? Can she do this? Can she do that? So these questions are, and usually the answers are quite favorable to the woman. Yes, relax, let it be. This is
Mudawana.
No, it's not. It's a complement to the Mudawana. And I'm using this text because it's Cordoban. Yes. So that the questions are, in some cases, they are very clearly from
material. Same approval in the handbag material.
Yeah. And this, there are many questions that still have to be studied, but the general impression one gets is that they are trying to make it easy to for everybody, for the husband, for the wife, and the...
I'm thinking about text number two in a modern context. An example of the Jews in Germany in the 19th, early 20th century, that they become Christian in order to assimilate it to the general German national society. And then come the Nazis, and actually they are saying to those who converted to Christianity, actually, we don't care about it because our definition of you being Jews are different. It's actually a racial definition. So actually, looking on text number two and what Hashem actually claimed here, and are you a Muslim or a non-Arab, Ajami? Actually, what he's saying here, and if you read in the old context, is I don't care about you going saying that you're Muslim or becoming Muslim. You are still an Ajami in my eyes. So, but the way he's doing this is so tricky. So this is what is so interesting in this text. So actually testing the knowledge in Islam and of course, if they have a positive answer, so we have another question and more and more. So we actually will never be graduating as Muslim in Israel because, but this is of course because he doesn't care because in his eyes there are still Ajami. This is what is considered for him that movie as the real criteria.
Yes, and sorry. But this is a very clever way to conciliate ethnicity or racism, put it, and religiosity, you know. He never, contrary to Nazi ideology you mentioned, or the loss of purity of blood in late medieval and early modern Spain, this is precisely, I will say, a coherent way to still stay religious and universalist while adopting ethnic criteria of belonging, you know? And this promotes a society in which it is inclusive from a religious point of view, but it is very hierarchical regarding your origins. And this is perfectly compatible to, I think, with monotheistic religions, universalistic monotheistic religions, not only with the case you mentioned today.
But I want to say that compatible, but always arousing tension.
Because yes, the always world, with tension,
this
always.
This is precisely what created
yes.
tension.
Yes, indeed.
In your mind,
I had a very simple question about text 3B. Why is it that if he died, forgive me if you covered this and I missed it, but why is it that if he died a Christian, his money would go to Beit and that? It's not a general rule about...
No, because he's an apostate.
Because he's more shadowy.
Because of apostasy.
That's what I suspected, yeah. The other thing going way back to forced conversion, I agree that it's a slippery term at best, and maybe a useless one. Alex Malet in a recent book about popular Muslim reactions to the Franks in the Levant, for instance, and I don't necessarily agree with it, but he says conversion at the point of a sword is not forced conversion, because you still have a choice.
Yes.
You die.
Yes.
When he says forced conversion, if you're forced to be baptized, then you're told now you're whatever, that's forced conversion. Which in my view, then most all Christian babies are forced converts.
Yes.
Yes.
The mention of Germany reminded me that somewhere else you spoke about Jews, Yahudi. And when you look in, inside, you see that there are former Jews, actually. You spoke about the conversion of Jews, but they were not Jews, actually. Most of your examples in Berlin several months ago were former Jews. Is this relevant to our discussion?
Because this comes later, this underground the Jews in this early period. This is underground, but so they were forced to convert. But everybody was forced to convert. This can be it was not only the Jews.
Last questions, comments? Is there anyone behind the pillar that I'm
just a small question. About why Surah 77? Why do you want to? What's in Surah 77?
I don't know, maybe some difficult Surah to pronounce. Maybe those who know Arabic better than I do can tell. Another thing that is surprising is that one of the arguments is what will the Abbasids say to us? I mean, this I find very striking because the Mayas wouldn't care about the Abbasids. They are, but they still. The argument is made if they know that we have a Christian as secretary. I mean, it's
well, the ambassador is doing exactly the same thing. I mean,
yeah, that's. I don't understand why this is.
They have Christian viziers at precisely the middle of the Mubarakah, and then immediately right afterwards there are Christian officials.
But it's like provincial, no? Like they are very provincial and they are looking at Baghdad. What would they Baghdad really, would say?
It's good to hear a term, Afdal, in Syriac. Pointed the best person, the Arabic is Afdal. This is a very central term in the legitimate discourse in Islam, in early Islam. So it is actually something that should be dealt with in the context of the legitimate discourse. It's interesting, of course, that between the polemic also between the Umayyads and the Abbasid, because the Abbasid, you know, and the Shias are claiming that Ali and descendants are Afdal, Ali is Afdal at last, because of its ancestor, one of the reasons, one of the many reasons. And also the Abbasid claim that they are belonging to the family of the Prophet, that's why they are Afdal, comparing to others who are considered to be Mafdul, like the Umayyads. So this is, I think, the context here.
Maybe. Okay, thank you very much.